I know the news coming out of the Middle East right now feels devastating and hopeless. And I've been asked by a lot of people to give my perspective on what is happening in the region. I've also been asked, wait a second, aren't you a liar?
That is Hasan Minhaj right there, stand-up comedian, TV host, who last month in an explosive piece in the New Yorker reported that he had fabricated several of the stories that he told in his stand-up comedy specials. Specifically, those stories were about Minhaj's experiences with racism and Islamophobia. In full disclosure, Minhaj has been a buddy of mine for many years. We came up together and I was so surprised and shocked to hear this story as well, but there's also nuance to it as well. We're gonna get into it in a minute, but first more details. Now, after receiving plenty of backlash, Minhaj has released a 20-minute YouTube video that was a little snippet of to address the scandal and present his side of the story. We're gonna get to some more clips of it in a second, but before we do, it's important to clarify what is in the New Yorker piece, what are the allegations? Reporter Claire Malone wrote at length about three of Minhaj's stories. In one, Minhaj claims that when he was in high school, he was targeted and physically assaulted by Craig Mondale, an undercover FBI agent who infiltrated his local mosque. Mondale was a real person, but he was in prison at the time when Minhaj claimed those events took place. He didn't even begin to work with the FBI until 4 years after the time of Minhaj's story. Minhaj claims the story was inspired by a pickup basketball game in which he was pushed to the ground by an older man whom he suspected of being an undercover officer. Let's hear Minhaj explain himself on that one.
I did have altercations with undercover law enforcement growing up, and that experience formed the basis of this story. But it didn't go down exactly like this. So I understand why people are upset. People face real danger at the hands of the police, and false stories can undermine real stories. I used this story to talk about Hamid Hayat. Hamid and I were part of the same NorCal Muslim community. When he got entrapped, it rocked our community and he spent 14 years in prison. We were the same age, same background, and like him, I also had run-ins with undercover agents. I was even physically harassed by them while playing basketball. When I am storytelling, every beat has to do multiple things in a funny and impactful way. With the story, I had to set up three plot points. The moment I realized authority figures hate being made fun of, why I named my show Patriot Act, and spotlight the story of Hamid Hayat. The problem is 99% of people watching Netflix have no idea the FBI spied on Muslims at mosques, or they don't even believe it was real. And I know this because when I performed earlier versions of the story in front of audiences, they had no idea what I was talking about.
Very interesting. In another story, Minhaj claims that he opened an envelope which spilled what he believed was anthrax onto his daughter. So he rushed her to the hospital, but the substance turned out not to be anthrax. However, neither NYPD nor any hospitals in the area had any record of this incident. Minhaj told Malone that the idea for the story came when he received a letter with a strange substance and told his wife, "What if this was anthrax?" The hospital incident never happened. And he didn't rush his daughter to any hospital. Let's see how Minhaj addressed that in his long explanation video.
I am sorry for embellishing the story, or if anyone was worrying about me and my family, I apologize. But let me make something clear. A letter with white powder was sent to my apartment in February of 2019. I opened it in the kitchen, powder fell on the table, and my daughter was just a few feet away. After 10 seconds of freaking out, I realized it was not anthrax and that someone was with me, because people had been with me since January 1st, 2019 after this happened.
Well, Netflix under fire today after its decision to pull an episode of a comedy show that was critical of Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman.
The truth is, when this news broke, my life got very scary. Saudi bots were spamming my socials. A threatening letter was sent to Netflix. I was getting weird phone calls at night. Then fake anthrax was sent to my house. Why even say you took your daughter to the hospital? The night of the anthrax scare, Bina and I, we got into a huge argument and she kept asking, "Hassan, what if this powder fell on our daughter?" So I created the hospital scene to put the audience in that same shock and fear that me and Bina felt playing out that night.
And the details of Minhaj's final story are more complicated than those first two. So let's discuss what we've heard so far and we'll tackle the now infamous prom rejection story after that. I'm curious to hear, you guys are not stand-up comedians, I'm curious to hear your thoughts first and then I'll weigh in afterward.
Like you say, not a comedian. I don't even think of myself as particularly funny. But my understanding of comedy is that it relies on embellishment and just weaving narratives to make an audience laugh. It's a performance, just as you wouldn't expect everything in a movie to be true. You don't expect the same thing of stand-up comedy. If he's doing it to make a point, if he's doing it to show a larger systemic problem, I don't really care. When the first story first broke and everyone was acting outraged by it, I didn't care then. I kind of don't care now. I'm also curious what you and Mondale think. There's definitely different elements here. There's definitely could be consequences, but it's distinguishable from someone just making up an instance of a hate crime and then going to the police. Like, he's doing this for entertainment, not to get somebody in trouble for something they didn't do. So I do think it's distinguishable.
Yeah, he's definitely not Juicy Smollett. I'm curious to hear Mondale's take.
Yeah, I definitely was about to say that. Let's be serious. And also, like, do these people can't read books. These people can't watch TV. What is Donald Trump's YouTube special about all his lies going to be? If this one was 20 minutes, Donald Trump owes us a 2-year special on all of his lies. Come on, guys, let's be serious. It's comedy. You think Richard Pryor did everything he said? You think Dolemite really did? You think Red Fox? I was upset with the original story. Now that I find out that New Yorker played him this way, it's absolutely disgusting and it's sensationalized. And another reason why we shouldn't be reading the New Yorker.
It's fascinating to hear both of your guys' takes, not really thinking it's a big deal, because I do agree. Like I said, it's not Juicy Smollett. This is not something you should be canceled for. I know Hasan is somebody who has a lot of integrity, is a great person, he's a kind person. But I actually have a little bit of a different take. I think certainly comics have the license to embellish. I've embellished stories in the past to some degree. I usually, when I tell personal stories, which isn't often, I actually usually sometimes tone them down because some of the things that happen to me are so crazy, nobody would believe it. So I actually take some crazy details out. But I've like conflated a couple of things before. I'll take two girlfriends and mash them into one to be able to make a joke happen or to explain something. But I think it is a little bit different when it is about real life people, you're making them identifiable, or you're talking about hate crimes. I do think instances like that, you need to be more careful. And you know, as Hasan's career blew up as somebody who is a truth teller and somebody who holds those in power to account, I think your relationship to your word and to your audience is very important. I guess the difference I see is, you know, if he's playing a character, if he was Carrot Top up there, maybe it's different, but he's using his real name. He's talking about real life events, using real people's names. And I think people do expect that to be true unless it's a silly story. Or again, like I said, unless it, you know, there's no negative consequence to the story being that way. And I do see it a little bit different. I think there's a little bit of a higher standard when you're hosting shows that are like The Daily Show or Patriot Act, and you're trying to hold other people to account and to their words. You know, I would assume he did, I don't know this for a fact, but I assume he did jokes on his show making fun of Kellyanne Conway's alternative facts. Yes, she was in government. Of course, that's far worse to have alternative facts than from an entertainer. But I just think it is a little bit different when it's a hate crime or when it's about real human beings whose reputations could be harmed from that. I'm curious if you guys feel me on that point at all.
Yeah, I definitely hear you, but I think the only real name he used was someone who was actually guilty of what he said in the story. It wasn't him that he was guilty of. But I mean, you know, like I feel like if I made a joke about the cop who killed Tamir Rice, I don't care about him. Like, I don't care that he's gonna get backlash that I said he's a murderer of little black boys that play with toys in the park. Even if I don't call that kid Tamir Rice, as it pertains to his ex, we'll talk about this, I guess, in the next part, in the next segment, about his ex-girlfriend. He went out of his way to protect her. I think this is where, for me, it gets muddy. To me, it almost was like humanizing so many people. He made the stories more relevant in a succinct way that people could also laugh at. And as a person who understands that people don't want to hear about my mom being sprayed with a water hose the entire story, I can make that a small story, say my mom, like a very quick and succinct story, and leave out some of the details, and some person might be saying, well, you didn't tell all of it. I think we have to be okay with someone who is that close to that situation telling it in that manner. Because when it did happen, and this is how I feel as a Black person, this is why I say parents of kids who are killed by cops can't speak on behalf of the entire community. You have every right to speak on behalf of your child. But when a Black kid is killed by a cop, it didn't just happen to your family. It happened to all of us. So it's not just the brother and his mosque story. It's also his story, because this person was the same age. They came up together and they went to the same mosque. So something happened to him too. And I think he has a right to make people feel that and blame the person who's responsible for it.
Yeah, I guess I just worry about people then having permission to doubt other stories. Doubt real stories, which is why. But let's go quickly into the rest of the story in part two, and then I want to hear Jordan's takes on it as well, more takes on it. As we mentioned, the final story that was highlighted in the New Yorker piece was about Minhaj dealing with racism on his high school prom night. Minhaj strongly disputes how the New Yorker reported on this story, so keep that in mind as we read you what Malone wrote. The central story of Minhaj's first Netflix special, Homecoming King, which was released in 2017, is about his crush on a friend, a white girl. Minhaj showed up on her doorstep the night of the dance, only to see another boy putting a corsage on her wrist. On stage, Minhaj says that his friend's parents didn't want their daughter to take pictures with a brown boy because they were concerned about what their relatives might think. But the woman disputed certain facts. She told me she'd turned down Minhaj, who was then a close friend, in person days before the dance. Minhaj acknowledged this was correct, but he said that the two of them had long carried different understandings of her rejection. The woman also said that she and her family had faced online threats and doxing for years because Minhaj had insufficiently disguised her identity, including the fact that she was engaged to an Indian American man. A source with knowledge of the production said that during the show's off-Broadway run, Minhaj had used a real picture of the woman and her partner with their faces blurred, projected behind him as he told the story. Now let's hear Minhaj refute just about every part of Malone's reporting with receipts, including an email from the woman saying that her parents had come a long way in regards to her marrying a man of color.
Her mom tells me they don't want her to go to prom with me because they'll be taking a lot of pictures and they don't want their family back home to see her with a brown boy. Bethany's mom did really say that. It was just a few days before prom. And I created the doorstep scene to drop the audience into the feeling of that moment, which I told the reporter. When the article says we had different understandings, what I clearly meant was that Bethany never knew how much her family being racist had affected me. That's why we had different understandings, not because Bethany denied this happened. In fact, Bethany basically confirmed in writing that racism was a factor in the prom rejection. I think my parents have come a long way too. And what would her parents have to come a long way from? Racism. I even emailed her to take down a tweet that might reveal her identity. Bethany then responded with a really nice email that ended with her saying, "P.S. Thanks for the heads up on the tweet. I deleted the other ones, but this one escaped me. It's shockingly hard to resurface old social media, apparently. Thanks too for always protecting me and my family. I don't think I've ever formally thanked you for that, and I do sincerely appreciate it. Even in the Netflix special, I don't use any real photos of Bethany or her family. Those are actors."
Yeah, this one seems way more legit to me. Nobody's exposed. You're taking real things, real emotions, and you're putting them into a tight storytelling vibe. That seems cool with me. Jordan?
I think part of this also is when a reporter is doing a feature and it turns into a hatchet piece, they still need it. The further they go into it, they still need to be really careful about what they report and what they write. And it seems like as maybe these investigations or these stories and unraveling them went on, they became a little sloppier, a little less, scrupulous. And this was the consequence. I mean, she didn't even verify that picture specifically. So now I'm starting to feel bad for him. I went from not caring to feeling bad for the guy.
I love it. Mondale, last thoughts.
I think it's a 20 minute documentary critique, one man show on what's wrong with attack journalism. Like this is someone completely going into this interview with a motive. I mean, if you listen to it, she's like, yeah, sure, that's understandable. All of this, and you can hear him giving her an excess of evidence to prove his side of the story, emails at the emails. And I just see this seemed like they had a motive, and this is the danger of unchecked or unreliable media.
Thanks for watching. If you become a member, you get to watch all this ad-free, except for, of course, this ad. Still, hit the join button below.